jeez. Talk about having technical issues. Damn. Oh, finally up and running. Welcome to Wasted Lunch, the perfect place to waste your lunch. I'm Paul McVeigh, and time is about 12 o'clock p.m. oven standard. Hope everybody's doing fantastic. It's Monday, time to get the week cranking again. Back at the grind, huh? Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, I hope everybody had a fantastic weekend. My weekend was pretty darn good. And today got greeted with something. You know, we've been already into the holiday season, early on Christmas holiday celebrating this year. And today, lots of snow. We had our first snow of this season last week. But today we had a real first snow that actually stuck, you know. It's not a foot of snow or anything like that, maybe, you know, a couple inches or whatever, but the snow actually stuck, covered the ground, made it nice and white and pretty outside. So, made me feel not as guilty about being Christmassy. Hell, I don't feel guilty about it at all, to be honest with you. I don't feel guilty one bit. But the one radio station's been playing the Christmas carols and everything, the traditional Christmas songs, have been playing on it. They play it 24/7. I'm trying to think of if it's 101.7 is the radio station. They always got the Christmas tunes going. So it was really nice today actually listening to the Christmas tunes in the car while driving with the big snowflakes coming down and the ground getting covered all nice and white. You know, it's a good feeling. Good feeling. So, wow. So, it's Monday. Yeah. Monday. I'll tell you, it's, you know, a lot of people dread this day. A lot of people absolutely dread it. You know, you get kind of rusty over the weekend, out of the swing of things, but and don't want to go back to the grind. But, you know, Mondays don't have to be bad, do they? They don't have to be horrible. Right? I mean, it's the beginning of another week of making money, right? For most of us, or making that money to trade. Oh, man, I'm actually burning up. I thought I'd be cooler where I'm at now as opposed to where I used to broadcast from, which was straight out of my kitchen studio. It's actually cooler where I'm at now, but I'm still pretty doggone warm. So I was surprised that I'm down here and I'm actually pretty warm. But, yeah, not bad, not bad at all. So I'm trying to think of any exciting features I've watched over the weekend. I watched something I've never really watched before. I grew up always being told that Red Skelton was funny. My uncle used to always tell me about Red Skelton, the Red Skelton program. And I was at a thrift store over the weekend. My wife and I were doing some holiday shopping. We get a lot of good stuff from thrift stores for people. And we were shopping and came across a Red Skelton DVD set. So for a few bucks, so I decided, yeah, you know what, I'll finally give this guy a chance, you know. I haven't watched him before. I mean, hell, the most I knew about Red Skelton was when he was in one of the Christmas specials. I think Rudolph's Shiny New Year, he was in there as Father Time. You know, that's the most I knew of Red Skelton right there. So I figured, oh, what the hell, I'll give it a shot. So I got it, and, you know, there's supposed to be like over 7.5 hours, I think, of Red Skelton. So got it, and I must say, I can see why people liked him. He was very likable and funny, had a lot of characters. You know, I've watched about 6 episodes now. The Red Skelton Show. And I don't know if these are the entire show or not, or if it's, or if these were just skits taken from the show. I'm not, you know, officially, I'm not certain on that, but it's a pretty funny guy. What's up, Joe? What's happening? Happy Monday. But yeah, the Red Skelton Show, I've watched quite a few episodes, and it's some pretty funny shit. The guy was talented and very likable. And what's funny about the show was, that, you know, they don't pretend. I mean, they know they're doing a TV show, and these are early television shows when television was still a new thing. And they make lots of jokes about the whole television production itself. You know, he'll say, Joe says, Happy Monday, brother. Well, thank you. But yeah, and Red Skelton, they'll be doing these skits. I'm talking about Red Skelton. And they'll be doing these skits, and, you know, Red will start cracking up laughing. He'll be like, well, this wasn't how it was in rehearsal. And they'll make jokes about the cue cards and that kind of stuff. And it's funny because you don't see that on TV. You just don't. And so it had to have been really, really funny when that was back in the 40s or 50s and this stuff is happening. It had to have been hilarious, these guys. And Red Skelton was, from what I'm seeing, he was very talented at pantomime. And that's one of the funniest things I've seen on these shows, was he did a bit where he was pretending he was eating ice cream in a movie theater. He was talking about ice cream. Eating ice cream started becoming popular in movie theaters. And he pantomimed it, and it was hilarious. And see, Joe says, your new setup makes me want to have a drink. Yeah. I got a little bit of everything down here. But, you know, and it's funny because I drink very moderately, Joe. Very, very moderate drinker. So, it's funny that I got a bar behind me here. But, you know, because I don't drink that much. I really don't. And when I do drink, it's usually beer, you know. It's usually beer. Not big into the booze. And then when I do drink beer, I'm not crushing them left and right, you know. That's very rare that I do that, but I like this new setup here. I really do. It's really comfy. It's really comfortable. And where I'm at right now also, if I get somebody, you know, actually here in person, right with me, I got the room to shoot it with one camera. Okay, that's another thing is I'd like to move forward and get to where, you know, I can have guests on every now and then. We could just do a one camera thing for now. Let's see, Joe says, looks good. Is that oak? Yes, it is. It is. And I'll tell you, it's this is oak. And I think what happened was, see, my father constructed this. Now, that's not to say that all of this he hand-carved. My dad, which he was an excellent woodworker, but he was really good at composition, I guess you would say, too. My dad would see things made out of wood that were beyond use, really, and he could take them and cannibalize them and turn them into really cool stuff. Like this back here, part of this, I think, was from an organ, okay? And my dad's really good at designing things too. He was a really good woodworker in general, but he was very good at constructing things and drawing them out. He spent immense amounts of time doing drawings and figuring out how things would look best put together, you know. I mean, did very elaborate work. At the house I grew up in, he made a fireplace mantle that ended up taking up a complete wall. It started out as a simple plain brick fireplace, and my dad started going with oak around it, and he just went crazy with it. Ended up doing the whole wall, multiple shelves everywhere, cupboards, and, you know, amazing stuff, amazing stuff. See, Sean's joined us. Hello, Sean. And somebody else has joined us, but I don't know who it is. Name didn't pop up, so sorry if I didn't get your name yet. Of course, if you comment, then I'll get your name. But, so that's where I got, you know, from my father is where I got my interest in woodworking. And then, I love these pillars here. There's another one on the other side of the mirror also. And I love those. That was actually one piece. My dad ended up splitting that and putting it on either side of the mirror. Let's see. Sean says, hi, Paul. Hi, Joe. I hope you're doing good, Sean. I feel bad. I don't know who else is on, but name didn't pop up. And it's hard for me to recognize the avatar from here. So, as you guys, avatars are teensy tiny teeny things. And Joe says hello right back at you. But my dad was his woodworking was big. He worked in epic scale, large scale. In fact, all the wood done up here, the ceiling is in oak also. It's all kinds of panels with little nooks and crannies and holes in them. It's actually a train track going around here. You know, my dad loved model trains, so. Sean says, got a new hat on today. Yes, I do. I haven't worn it much. Isn't it funny? Teresa hates this hat. I don't know why. She doesn't like this hat or this style of hat on me. I don't know why. You know, taste is a fickle thing, I guess, but she doesn't like this hat. I'll tell you one thing I do like about this hat, okay? One, it's pretty warm. No, it doesn't cover my ears or anything like that, but it keeps the snow off of my dome, you know, and that's a plus. I like that, and the fact that when I get in my car, I don't have to worry about taking my hat off. I got a problem getting in my car, and if I have, you know, most hats are kind of high, and I get in the car, and the damn roof, the ceiling inside my car ends up knocking my hat off if I've got most hats on. And this one's nice. I can slip into my car sleekly without my hat being knocked the hell off and landing on the driveway, so that's a plus. But, so technically this is an old hat. I've had it, oh dear God, probably 15 years. But Kangol, or whatever, you know, if you're interested in hats at all, that's a brand of hat. Got the little kangaroo guy on the back. But, you know, it's funny. It's funny about hats, you know, because this is not a toboggan. And if it was really cold outside, my ears would be freezing off, you know, period with this. But, you know, it's just made out of wool. But that little bit of wool is enough to keep my noggin warm, you know. And once again, that's a beautiful thing about winter altogether is you're allowed to wear anything you want to wear and not feel like an asshole about it. You know, it doesn't matter if you look like an idiot in the wintertime. As long as it's warm, you have a license to look like an idiot in the wintertime. And that's a good thing. Now, myself, personally, I don't worry about looking like an idiot any time of the year, but a lot of people do. A lot of people get self-conscious and worry about that. Well, it's winter time, so go out there and wear whatever the hell you want to wear. You know, it doesn't matter. You know, you want to borrow your wife's pink or mauve scarf, you know. If it's 20 degrees out or, my God, see, or negative 20, you know, the colder it gets, the more you're allowed to look like an asshole. You know what I mean? Let's see, Sean says, do you wear earmuffs to warm your ears when wearing the hat? No, I don't wear earmuffs. I've got a huge scarf. I've got a 12-foot-long scarf, and sometimes I will swirl that around my head a la Taliban style. Let's see, Joe says, did your dad pass any of that woodworking talent down to you? Yes, I would have to say yes. However, my woodworking is a completely different style of woodworking than my father. My dad went for more traditional style woodworking and worked on a huge scale, whereas I am more avant-garde. I'm more into 100% more modern style woodworking, more modern fashion looking, whereas my dad was always going for an old-fashioned look. And I work on smaller projects. Jonah says, good afternoon, Paul. Good afternoon, Jonah. But yeah, my dad was always working on big things, big pieces of furniture, large rooms, whereas I try and keep it contained. I try and work on smaller projects. I enjoy doing finishes on woodwork, on projects. My dad hated doing finishing. He did not like doing finishing. Didn't like the smell of the stuff. He liked the effects of it, but he really did not enjoy the process of doing finishes. Whereas, I don't know, maybe I enjoyed what the fumes did to me or something, that I've never really had a problem doing finishes. So back in the days, my dad would do a lot of the main work on things. And, like I said, for lack of a better word, composition. My dad was so good at sitting back and just a pencil and a notebook and a cup of coffee and some smokes. My dad would be going to town drawing things out and designing different projects. And that's what I need to do more of. But my next big project is going to be building a whole wall bookcase. And that's going to be in the room that I finally just got done wallpapering last week. Which, the whole room, we're going for an Asian motif. Yes, an Asian motif. What's happening, Michael? I don't know why I'm calling you Michael. I call you Michael, Mike Lentz on here. And, I have a habit. When I see you guys' name pop up, I'll read it just like it says. And it's like, I never called Mike Michael in my life. Never saw Mike and said, hello, Michael. It's always been Mike. So, but your name is down there all proper, Michael. So, saying it like that, but we're talking a little bit about woodworking. Mike's gotten his hands dirty with woodworking too. Mike was working on a deck over the summer. Pretty big damn project. But yeah, my next big project is going to be a whole wall of wood. Let's see, Michael says, never have. Yeah, if you're talking about your name thing, yeah, I don't think I've ever called you Michael, except for reading your name off. It's a good thing about my name. There's not too many ways to get it wrong. Did you ever know somebody who, when they got older as an adult, decided they wanted to be called something different? They wanted to be called their proper name. I had some friends. I had a friend, Jamie. Always called him Jamie. Always friggin' called him Jamie. Forever. Then it reaches about 25, 26. It's James now. You ever know somebody who did one of them shits? That's weird. I see Mike says, I'm going to change my name to something swanky now, just so you have to say it. Okay, so Mike's going to be getting fancy schmancy on us. Michael Chazmere Lint. Chaz. Yeah, name like Chaz says, punch me in the dick, doesn't it? That's what that name says. Chaz. Oh, gosh. No offense to any Chazes out there. It just means you deserve to get punched in the dick for your name, that's all. No, I'm just kidding. If you were happen to name Chaz, be named Chaz. Oh my gosh. You know, the popular names now for boys are last names. You know, those things have been really in vogue for a long time, you know. Let's see, Mike says it sure does. I imagine you mean about the Chaz thing. It's a please punch me in the cock name. Yeah, I think it is. You know, but I lucked out. I was given, you know, a 2,000-year-old name, so, you know. It's been tried and tested. It ain't fancy, but it works. Paul. I mean, that's all there is to it. What stinks about my name is everything, every sound people make sounds like it. You know, so hanging out with friends or something, somebody smashes their finger and goes, oh, and you're like, what? It sounds like Paul. Everything seems to sound like Paul. You know, people sigh and you think they're calling your name. But what the hell was I saying? Oh, yeah, first names for boys. People have been naming their boys last names. A lot of, you know, like, I think it started with that Sawyer stuff, you know. And I mean, you know, because I look at, we get these lists. Kids go to a new class and they get lists that says their classmate's name. And there's all these damn kids with last names for first names, you know. Sean says, my name Sean means gift from God. There you are, getting high and mighty on us again, aren't you, Sean? Yeah, self-righteous little such and such. No, I'm teasing you, Sean. But, and Sean, I believe one of the spellings of Sean is an Irish variant on the name John, if I'm not wrong, anyways. But, yeah, there's some funny-ass names people are using now. Now, you know, and there's, you ever meet people with those, I mean, old-time Bible names like Hezekiah, shit like that? Those ones, Hezekiah and Jebediah and stuff like that. You don't hear them too much in the more urban areas, but I'll tell you what, you go down in southeast Ohio, down by the river or West Virginia or somewhere like that, you'll start hearing them Old Testament names. You'll start hearing people with those names. Very popular down in the hills. Ezekiel. Stuff like that. I can't think of any good ones now, of course. Well, I wasn't planning on talking about names, but you know how this stuff works. It just goes in one direction and flows into another. You know. Let's see. Joe says, my name is very original. Yeah. Joe. Never heard that one before. Sean says, or Amish country. Yeah, you do. You'll hear them names in Amish country, too. Yeah, you will hear them out in the Amish country. Yeah, those are very popular names out there. They are, because those people are old school. You know, old school. Although, you know, I did see a buggy a couple weeks ago that had LED lights on it. No shit. You know, which I was happy about because it was at nighttime, so it made them more recognizable. You know, I didn't do the usual, oh shit, I almost killed an Amish family before I noticed their lantern thing, you know, rear end them. But because they had LED lights. But in a way, it pissed me off because I'm like, these sons of bitches, ain't that cheating? You know, isn't that cheating that they got LED lights, you know? And I was just, you know, next time I'm probably going to see one with those neon bar lights and stuff. Wouldn't that be some shit? See an Amish buggy with that or hydraulics, you know, with the buggy bouncing and shit. Let's see. Sean says, aren't there Amish named Paul? I'm sure there are. Joe says, das pimp buggy. Yeah, boom, 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 bouncing and shit. I'll tell you, I have noticed this, and you know, I don't live in the middle of Amish country, but where I live now, I see Amish a lot more than when I lived in Massillon. Although I would see them every now and then, but I see them a hell of a lot more now where I live. But they got these, buggies that are like two-wheeler buggies. Okay, they're like sport buggies, and these are the ones that seem. It seems like that's what the young kids are allowed to drive. It's like every time I see one of these, they don't have a roof or anything. Okay. Every time I see one of them, there might be one, two, or three Amish teenagers riding it. Right? Have you ever seen the little buggies, guys? They don't have a roof on. These are, I don't know, I call them sport buggies. You know, coupes. Or whatever, but they got the young kids on them. I remember reading about, this is years ago, about this Amish kid getting ticketed because he had some big-ass stereo, battery-powered even, in a buggy and was, you know, bumping bass and shit out of a buggy. Now, that was somewhere in Amish country, and he got a ticket for that shit, and it was the funniest shit. I should have cut out that article. You know, so much shit I've seen in the paper that, you know, you need to start a scrapbook and keep a hold of that shit. Sean says, I don't think I have, so you haven't seen one of them buggies. Yeah, first time I seen one of them sport buggies, I was driving on Warmington Road, if anybody knows that road. And one of those little bastards, young kid, pulled out right in front of me in one of those. Now, I realize that they're smaller than the average buggy, but they're not a whole hell of a lot faster. Not fast enough to pull right the hell out in front of me. You know, I almost hit this kid. And, I you know, I didn't go road rage on him. I'm pretty chill when I'm driving, even when people pull bullshit. Usually, I'm pretty chill. But, yeah, I ended up finding, you know, and the bastard pulled in front of me at a spot where I couldn't just go around him because there's hills and stuff, and, you know, that's a stupid thing to do that on a hill, but finally got to the point where I could get past him, and as I'm passing, I look over him and give him this cold-ass look, and he, you know, did one of these, looked at me, and I quickly looked away like, you know, I was going to get out and, you know, oh, gosh, yeah. That's the first time I've seen one of them. Let's see, Joe says, back to work. Catch you later, Paul. All right, later on, Joe. Be good at work. Have a productive day. Hopefully enjoyable, too, as well. At the Amish, yeah, you know, they're an interesting breed, aren't they? And, I mean, they are totally their own shit, you know? They're their own thing. Very weird. Not necessarily bad folks, I'm not saying that, but weird compared to the rest of us, you know. Weird. I mean, for crying out loud, they pay for their medical bills with cash, and they actually pay them off, you know. That's not American, you know. They're not, I don't think most of them live in debt, which is very un-American, you know. They're good with their money. You know, I'm sure there's exceptions, but, you know, they don't live extravagantly. You know, they seem to live within their means. And they live like it's, you know, 1700s. And that's weird, too. I don't think I could go Amish for very long. Well, I couldn't go for it too long. I got that sleep apnea shit, you know. Have to have a horse-powered, you know, CPAP machine. I don't know how the hell good that would work, you know. But, so I wouldn't be very good at being Amish. I don't know how you guys would be. You guys think you could go Amish for a while? Like girls with hairy legs, do you? Seen an Amish lady with a beard one time, outside of a hospital. Sean says, isn't that their religion? Well, I don't know. I mean, it's their lifestyle and their culture, being Amish. You know, technically, I think they're Christian. You know, they read the Bible, and I think they believe in the Holy Trinity and that, but I don't. You know, I'm not going to sit here and bullshit you. I don't know exactly how their, you know, I don't know a whole lot about their church and stuff like that. I don't, because I've never been Amish. But what's funny about that is that I am not 100% not Amish. Okay. There was somebody in my family a few generations back that was Amish, that jumped the fence on my mother's side of the family. Yeah, we had a fence jumper. Yeah. So, I guess that kind of gives me license to make fun of Amish people, doesn't it? You know, but yeah, we had a fence jumper in our family, I guess. I think it was a great-grandfather. It was the first convert to be turning into an English. Let's see, Sean says, is it true about the cousin thing, or is it just a myth? Okay, are you talking, okay, when you say cousin, and we're talking about old-fashioned-ass people, it makes me think, are you talking about, like somebody, like, marrying their cousin and stuff, weird shit like that? Is that what you're talking about when you say the cousin thing? Because I'm not sure I follow you. Oh, Raj, that's Raj McAllister on here, and he's saying, hello, how we doing, Raj? I wasn't sure if that was you or not. Your avatar was kind of ambiguous, so I wasn't sure if that was you or somebody else, so I wasn't going to say, hey, is that you, you know, how we doing, Raj? And then it turned out to be, you know, Francine so-and-so. Sean says, yes, that. I don't know if the Amish marry their cousins or not. I don't know. You would think their gene pool would be sort of shallow, though. I mean, they're not, ain't exactly billions of them running around. So you would think they'd have more limited options than we do. You know, I mean, like, you know, I mean, we could turn around. Well, not me, I'm married, but, you know, us English people, we can go out and marry somebody of any ethnicity, any culture we damn well want. And they don't have those options, so I don't know if they marry their cousins or not. I don't know. I have to look that shit up. I have to Google that shit to figure that one out, because I don't know. I don't know. It wouldn't surprise me. You know, I've been reading a lot of old books, and when I say old books, I'm saying 1800s and shit. And I'll tell you that marrying your cousin used to be a popular thing in a lot of cultures. Okay, I've been reading the Arabian Nights, you know, Tales of the Arabian Nights, 1001 Nights, or whatever the hell you want to call it. And that's an old-ass book. It's an old book. And a lot of those stories, you know, they're talking about motherfuckers marrying their cousins. You know, their first cousins. That was, you know, so that was obviously part of their culture, too. But, I mean, Western culture, people used to marry their first cousins a lot, too, which, in my modern mind, you know, it's like, God, that's fucking disgusting, but that used to be popular shit, you know? I don't know why. Let's see, Sean says, I know Robert E. Lee was married to his cousin, so was Charles Darwin. Yeah, and they probably weren't considered freaks, either. You know, they probably weren't considered freaks, even though they were banging their cousins. You know, which I think to most of us nowadays, it's like, yeah, that's disgusting and potentially criminal. I don't know. I mean, aren't there some damn laws about that stuff? I don't think you're allowed to cornhole your cousin or anything like that, but maybe you are. I don't know. But, yeah, that used to be really popular stuff. And it isn't now. At least, not around here it isn't. You know, I mean, you got the jokes, of course, about people in West Virginia and, you know, shit like that, but I don't know. And then you've got the jokes about mutations and freaks coming out of that. And I don't know how true that stuff is either. I don't know how true that is. You know, the whole inbreeding, and I think there's some truth to that. Isn't there some science behind that? You know, mutated kids or something by inbreeding. I know it causes problems with animals, with dogs and stuff. You know, they try to. And that's another thing, since we're talking about inbreeding, I've always thought it was kind of freaky about royalty. You know, they do a lot of inbreeding. You know, those royal families do a lot of damn inbreeding, which is nasty. And then, you know, these people are supposed to be looked up to and held in high regards, and they're spadoinkling with their relatives. You know, that's always struck me as weird. Yeah, nasty. I got a really interesting book, and I'm going to have to pull it out sometime, but I think it's called The Intimate Sex Lives of Famous People, and that's exactly what this book is. It is about the personal sex lives of famous people, and it's got all kinds of people throughout history, and it talks about their sex lives, and it's an interesting book. I know it sounds sleazy and perverted and well, it is, but it's a good read. Sean says, yes, that is true. Your child will have some deformities and or mental problems. Wow, yeah. That's what I always heard. That's what I always thought. And, you know, and like I said, I knew that was a problem with, like, animal breeders. You know, trying to be careful not to inbreed their animals too much. So I would think that would extend over to humans also. Oh, shit. It's time to get some more coffee. And I ran out of smokes. Got another pack. I'm going to have to go grab those bastards. So what exciting is going on with all of you guys? Anybody got some amazing shit about to happen to them today? Projects going on. Oh, man. Let's get some coffee. Ooh, there's some fresh cigarettes. Look at that. They're so bad for you, but they're so enjoyable. Let's see. Sean says, I just read that FDR also married his cousin Eleanor. Her last name was already Roosevelt. What the hell? She didn't have to change it when she got married. FDR married his cousin? I didn't know that either. That's some fucked up shit. And he was a president, for crying out loud. So, I mean, if he was doing it, he became the president, shit. You know, then that makes it look pretty damn normal. Got the president of the United States married to his cousin. Yeah, that sets a hell of an example. I got the hot coffee. Doo-doo-doo. How did we get on inbreeding subject anyway? So talk about the Amish, I think. Ow! There we go. I don't need that knee anyways. Don't need that knee. I do need these smokes. There we go. All right. Yeah, what's going on with you guys? Anything exciting? Get this set up better. There we are. See, Sean says it says her father, Elliot, was a brother of Teddy Roosevelt. Huh. Wait, hold up here. Her father was a brother of Teddy Roosevelt. Yeah, because those Roosevelts were all related, weren't they? That's weird. I don't know. I couldn't do that. You know. I don't know how many of those people got married to their cousins. It was an arranged thing or what. But I'm telling you, you guys start reading some old-ass books and you'll see it was popular. It was popular shit. Let's see. What's going on with you today, Mike? Roger? Sean? Anything fun happening? Is it snowing where you're at? See, Sean says, yes, Theodore and Franklin were related. Yeah, I knew they were related. I just didn't know how close. You know, I didn't know how close they were related. But, you know, I mean, geez, I don't know, man. I think of that, and it's like, marrying your own cousin, that's freaky shit. But I'll tell you who was, let's see, Sean says, I woke up just in time for a wasted lunch. All right. I woke up early today. I had to, damn it. Couldn't sleep in today. Had to wake up real friggin' early. Which, sleep is a, sucks for me. I've got, sleep apnea, and my mask is so old and so busted up, and I am such a metro billy. I've got duct tape holding this shit together. Now, I don't duct tape it to my head, you know. That would rip half of what little hair I have left out of my scalp. So I don't duct tape it to my head. But I've got straps and shit duct taped because this piece of plastic busted off of my mask. And I have insurance. So it's like, you know, I know. Sounds like, Paul, you're just dumbass for not doing that. But I, you know, the respiratory therapist I got doesn't take my insurance. So I'm going through an insurance change right now. That's fun shit. See, Mike says we got some snow over the weekend, about 4 inches, but it's mostly gone now. Yeah, we got a couple inches today. It's not going to stay long, though. Let's see, Roger says, homesick, enjoying your show. Snow here. Well, I'm glad you're enjoying the show, Rog. And, you know, how things go is, you know, we talk about shit and don't, you know, don't be afraid to, you know, opine and share. It's a community thing. Let's see, Mike says, working in Erie today, and they have almost none. Oh, shit. How long does it take to get to Erie from where you're at, Mike? A couple hours? Mike's up in Buffalo. Which, I don't... I don't think I've ever been to Buffalo. Well, maybe when I was a little kid. I was in Buffalo. And that was about it. Yeah, today we really, I mean, that snow was, it was that soggy snow. That shit that comes straight down and it's fast. We had that kind of snow today. You know, you get all kinds of snow. And this was the pretty big shit. But let's see, Mike says hour and 40 minutes. Okay. All right. I think I guessed on that. I think I guessed an hour and a half. I don't know if I did that out loud or if I'm just saying that now to make it seem like I'm slick. I think I guessed on it. Hour and 40 minutes. That's not too bad. But if you got to drive through shit, you know, if it's snowy as hell and then you got to drive through that shit. Which, Mike, I don't even know what the hell you do. Got no idea what the hell you do for a living. I don't know if you're in construction or dwarf porn. I have no clue what you do. I don't think I've ever asked you. Rog, what are you doing nowadays for making that loot? I know I'm not making any loot, damn it. I wouldn't mind it. A couple people have asked me about sponsorship. Let's see. Mike says, commercial and industrial HVAC. So, you suck and blow. Is that it? Yeah, I know that. I wasn't trying to be a prick there, Mike. I was just kidding. Heating and cooling. Which I wish I knew more about that shit. Because, all jokes aside, when that shit goes down, it ain't fun. I had, I probably don't know half the shit you know about that. But the pollster did have to replace a furnace blower one time. I did that successfully. So I felt pretty good about that. But I probably don't know all the shit you do about that stuff. Rod says masonry, which I was going to guess that out loud. I knew back in the days you used to slap them bricks down. But I didn't know if you were doing that shit full time. Masonry. That doesn't sound like a fun job to be doing outside right now. Let's see, Mike, I'm going to throw you an invite, all right, to hop on. We'll see if you accept it.
If you feel like hopping on, man, go for it. I'm throwing you an invite just for the hell of it. If you don't feel like hopping on, don't worry about it. But Mike has participated in the show 8 million times, and I've never had him on the air. So, you know, that's why I threw you an invite, because, you know, it's like, I've got to have you on here sometime. Which, money, yeah.
Money, yeah, I don't know. Some people have talked to me about sponsorship. Could you imagine that? Me, sponsored? Damn. That'd be different, wouldn't it? I'll tell you, it wouldn't bother me. I wouldn't mind being sponsored. And I really wouldn't give a shit what it was either, product-wise. I'm not worried about that shit. I think I'm easy. I think I'd take just about any sponsorship right now, but yeah, that'd be pretty funny shit. Like I said earlier, I was talking about that skeleton show, Red Skeleton show, and it was funny watching that show because one of the times he had this huge Geritol banner above his head while he was doing the show. Sean says, that's what she said. Are you talking about sucking and blowing, Sean? I'm going to have to elaborate on that. But, yeah. Old Red Skeleton had a huge-ass Geritol sign above him, and I'm like, oh my gosh. See, ever since TV started, you know, sponsorship has been a huge thing, you know. Another thing that interests me is, Sean says, no, I'm easy. Oh, I'm easy. That's what she said. Yeah, well, me too. I'm a hussy. I'm a cheap girl. I watch that indie racing, you know, or the Formula One stuff. I don't know a whole lot about it, but it interests me. And I like watching the old films about it. And back in the days, these guys didn't have sponsors and shit like they do now. I mean, back in the old days when these guys drove these cars, usually the drivers of these cars were mechanics too. And knew their cars inside and out. And, you know, I'm trying to think of when sponsorship things started getting big with the Formula One. If that was in the 70s when it really started getting big. Or the 60s. But before that, you know, there weren't stickers and shit plastered all over their cars. You know. And, you know, that was back when people were throwing a lot of their own money in their own car. And I just think it's really interesting. Whereas TV, you know, there's been advertisements and shit for TV, on TV shows forever, commercials, and, you know, radio. I listen to these old radio shows on YouTube and LibriVox, and if you guys probably heard me talk about LibriVox, but if you don't have the LibriVox app on your phone and you got some extra space, I'm telling you, that shit is worth getting. It really is. If you have trouble sleeping, that's a good app to have. And basically, it's all audiobooks, is what LibriVox is. It's LibriVox. And I think it's a .org, I think. I don't know. Just Google it. It'll pull it up. But and what they have are thousands of people who volunteer their time to read these books out loud and record them. Okay. So there's a lot. I don't know about you guys, but there are a shitload of books out there that I've thought about over the years. I would like to read this classic book. And then you start reading them, and it's got this old-ass, archaic English, and you're, like, having a hard time trudging through this old book. I've done that with books, I'll admit it, where I've been like, oh, gosh, this is some rough reading. But with the LibriVox thing, somebody else has already done that work for you. Somebody else has sat their ass down and recorded themselves reading this, some of this old, hard-assed read English. Okay, somebody else has already done that work, and you just listen to them. Okay, and it really is, it's that LibriVox shit is really cool. I listen to it all the time, going to sleep, you know, put on a story, and you know, because what these are, what the books are what they call public domain, or free license. You know, the license ran out. Somebody doesn't own the trademarks to it anymore. And anybody can read it and record themselves reading it. And LibriVox doesn't cost any money either. It's free. It's free. And that's what... Alright. Had a brief pause there. Had to take a call. It was my producer. So, no options on that. So... sorry about the delay there, but had to take it. But LibriVox is cool because it has a lot of old stories that I will admit my lazy ass would not trudge through. But if somebody has already done the work for me, it's you know, how much work is that? Putting on some headphones or what I like to do is have that shit. I've got some old computer speakers that aren't hooked up to a computer, and I plug those in, plug them into my phone, and run the audio through it so it's nice and loud. And I can listen to it, you know, let that story run for hours, and sit back, relax, fall asleep listening to it, and you know, which can make for some weird-ass dreams. You know, because there's a, you know, if you guys like good old-fashioned macho stories and stuff, there's a lot of Conan stories on it, which I love the Conan stories. I mean, you know, I mean, if you're a man and you don't like Conan, I don't know what the hell to tell you. I don't know what to tell you, except you're probably a vegetarian also. But a lot of Conan stories on there. And I'll start listening to those and then fall asleep. And then, you know, in the middle of my dreams, I'm fighting pirates and shit like that, you know, and gigantic snakes and dragons and crazy shit happening in my dream because, you know, I fall asleep listening to these stories and then they cross over into my dream. So I guess you want to beware of that. You can have some funky ass dreams listening to audiobooks, but, you know, I've had that happen. So that can be pretty weird, but, you know, like Mike there, he's got an hour and a half drive. You know, Mike, if you had LibriVox or whatever, you could be listening to that shit while you're doing your drive. And it doesn't cost anything, you know. I mean, most audiobooks, you got to go out and you got to buy them. I've even heard radio commercials for these clubs where you know, get like a different audiobook every couple weeks or something like that. And I'm like, yeah, screw that, you know. There's a little bit of commercial shit on LibriVox now because they got to make some kind of dough. What's up, Mike? talking about audiobooks right now and LibriVox. But see, that's the beauty of this LibriVox thing is, yeah, now they got commercials, but they don't last that long. And, you know, you've got thousands of stories to choose from. And they've got them broken down into genres, too. So you can browse through the genres of books. And, you know, it's just good. LibriVox is good shit. It really is. It's a good thing. I don't know if you guys have ever gotten into it, but it's a nice setup. It works for me, you know. So, it's a good way to pass the time. And if you want, another thing you can do with LibriVox is if there's that one story that you truly like and you keep re-listening to it, you can download that thing. And you can have it right on your phone, and to the point where if you don't have service or something like that, you can listen to it whenever you want to. So that's nice, too. But, you know, I've got a couple younger kids, and they've got selected stories that they like hearing over and over again. And, you know, it's like when one of my kids has trouble sleeping, throw on the old LibriVox, turn on that story, and they listen to that, and they're snoozing in no time. So, but what I really like about it is the fact that I hear and learn about these stories that ordinarily I wouldn't have taken the time to read. Because reading's a commitment, you know, especially in the 21st century. And we're not used to committing to anything, you know, nowadays. I mean, we're used to pushing a button and all that shit reaching us instantaneous, you know, instant gratification. You know, we order something on Amazon, get it the next damn day sometimes. I mean, we're used to having shit now. So sitting back and reading a book, you know, if you haven't done that for a while, I'm sure you remember that it's a real commitment. You know, although you're not physically doing a whole hell of a lot of anything, taking the time out to sit down and read, it takes a long time to read a decent-sized book. You know that. It takes a long-ass time. So, there's a lot of books I've heard on LibriVox that have inspired me to go out and buy real physical copies of these books because, you know, I've already gotten through that. You know, a lot of the times when you read the first couple chapters of a book, you got an idea as to how hard it's going to be to stick with a book, you know. I mean, because if you read a few chapters and it's boring as hell, I don't know about you, but I got the feeling like maybe I'm going to stop reading this right now because I don't see this paying off, you know. But when you listen to it, somebody else is already reading it and you get drawn into it. You know, it's easy to get past that stage. It's almost like a preview. And I've done that with a lot of books. And I found a lot of cool old authors that way. See, Sean says, Paul, what's your favorite book? Oh, dear God. I'll tell you, one of my all-time favorite books, it's technically, it's a hardcover. I've got a hardcover book. It's actually a trilogy of the first three books of a series, and it's the Guardians of the Flame series by Joel Rosenberg. It is not Shakespeare, I will say it right now. Okay. It is not high art kind of shit here. I mean, it's a fantasy novel. Like I said, it's the first three books slapped into one. And I will say that is the most enjoyment I've ever had reading was the first, second, and third time I've read that big-ass book. And it is about these kids. They get into role-playing and stuff and end up being in this realm that they're role-playing in. They end up being transferred into this world. Okay. So it's like a D&D kind of thing. Kind of like the old Dungeons & Dragons cartoon. That's kind of the story here. It's something like that. And like I said, it is not fancy literature by any means, but enjoyable, it is that, 100%. And so I'd have to, although I don't like saying anything about favorites, but if I only had one book, I guess I'd choose to have that book. It's really, really good book. And I'm sure it's out of print nowadays, too. I'm sure it's out of print. But it's good stuff. Really good. Guardians of Flame, Joel Rosenberg. And I got that book for next to nothing at a used book sale at a campground, of all places, when I was a kid. And that book really turned me on to fiction reading. So, let's see, Sean says, my cat is playing with the laundry. Hmm. Oh, that's cool. Your poor cat. I'm sorry, I cannot hear about your cat without thinking about what you guys almost put that poor cat through for your truth or dare. And you guys didn't. You know, so I need to give you that much credit, but you almost did. Ah, gosh. And if nobody else was tuned in for that show, yeah, that was a pretty bad one. But you guys didn't do anything, so that's good. Let's see, Sean, how about you? What's your favorite reading? And I'll tell you what, here's another close book. And I'm going to say this especially for your sake, Sean, because you're a Civil War nut. Is I think the book was called Sparks Around the Campfire. And if you could ever find that book, I think it was printed in the 1860s. It's mostly first-hand accounts from the Civil War. And I'm not a Civil War nut, but I absolutely loved this book. And you would like this book, I'm sure. Sean says The Outsiders is his favorite. Okay, well, that didn't take you too long to give me an answer on that. Let's see, Sean says, or The Last Full Measure. Is that the name of a book, The Last Full Measure? Or is this having to do with laundry and cats? But I think it was Sparks Around the Campfire was the name of this book. It was printed not long after the Civil War. Okay, and from what I recall, most of it was first-hand accounts from the Civil War experience. From people who were in the damn war. And really interesting because it's not a novel. This is a decent sized book, but it wasn't a novel or anything like that. Sean says, yeah, it's a book based in the Civil War. Okay, The Last Full Measure is a book based in the Civil War. Okay. But Sparks Around the Campfire is nice and has nice bite-sized sections to read. Okay. You know, from what I remember, it was a decent-sized book, but it wasn't just a novel or something like that. You know, it'd be like one chapter would be this person's story about whatever happened during the war. Next one would be somebody else's. So, books like that tend to be, for me anyways, really fast reads. And, And what I liked about the book was, you know, so many first-hand perspectives put into book form. That made that interesting to me. Wasn't reading about the strategy or anything like that. I was reading about the first-hand account and experience of these people who were in the Civil War. And that, to me, is exciting whenever I can read that stuff. It's a lot more exciting than hearing about war strategies and things like that. To me, it is. You know, hearing somebody who was in the shit talking about exactly their experience personally, it's more adventurous for me to read that. You know, kind of puts you in somebody else's shoes during these major events that, you know, you can only imagine what they were like. And then when somebody's putting down their account of it, you know, I think that's as close as you're going to get besides actually being in the war itself. So, but yeah, if you could ever find a copy of that, I'm telling you, you'd really dig that one. I'm pretty sure it's called Sparks Around the Campfire. And just talking about it makes me want to Google it now. So that was a good-ass book. Really good book. And I'll admit, that's one of the few books I've read cover to cover on the Civil War, was that book. But, I have a few books on wars, different wars and stuff like that, and the ones that I tend to read the most, or read the most of that book, are the ones that have lots of first-hand accounts. It just grabs my interest. It just does. I don't know why. Oh, man. So, I think it's getting about that time where I should be wrapping it up and getting to that time. Let me check my fake watch here to where I need to tell myself to get on that damn treadmill. Yeah. You can see I look excited about that, right? But the time goes really quick on here. It does. Just sitting around BSing about things. Before I know it, an hour goes here. An hour goes there. It's hard to stop myself, damn it. But I got you. It's getting about that time, so I'm going to wish you guys a fantastic day. I hope everything goes great in whatever you're doing. And thank you guys for watching and participating. And I want to thank anybody who ended up watching this after it was already recorded. But, the pollster has to get up and make himself do something. Let's see, Mike says, sorry, Paul, it's loud as hell in the factory I'm at. Couldn't hear a lot of today's show. Mike says, we'll tune in tomorrow. Thanks, Mike. You can always watch it after the fact anyways. Sean says, have a good day, Paul. God bless. God bless you, Sean. Thank you. I appreciate that. Need all the blessings I can get. Like I said, I got to make myself get on that damn treadmill. You know, that's another thing. Technology helps me out there, too. I can throw something on my phone and watch them while I'm treadmilling. All right, Mike, you be careful in that damn factory, dude. And Sean, whatever you're doing, do it well. And I'll catch up with you guys tomorrow. So stay out of trouble. Be safe. Have fun. Look out for your brothers and sisters out there. And I will see yous later. Bye.